Without Remorse by Tom Clancy. This book is read by Michael Prichard. Arma virumque cano, Publius Virgilius Maro. Beware the fury of a patient man. John Dryden. Prologue. Meeting places. November. Camille had either been the world's most powerful hurricane or the largest tornado in history. Certainly it had done the job to this oil rig, Kelly thought, donning his tanks for his last dive into the Gulf. The superstructure was wrecked, and all four of the massive legs weakened, twisted like the ruined toy of a gigantic child. Everything that could safely be removed had already been torched off and lowered by crane onto the barge they were using as their dive base. What remained was a skeletal platform which would soon make a fine home for local game fish, he thought, entering the launch that would take him alongside. Two other divers would be working with him, but Kelly was in charge. They went over procedures on the way over, while a safety boat circled nervously to keep the local fishermen away. It was foolish of them to be here. The fishing wouldn't be very good for the next few hours, but events like this attracted the curious. And it would be quite a show, Kelly thought, with a grin, as he rolled backwards off the dive boat. It was eerie underneath. It always was, but comfortable too. The sunlight wavered under the rippled surface, making variable curtains of light that trained across the legs of the platform. It also made for good visibility. The C4 charges were already in place, each one a block about 6 inches square and 3 inches deep, wired tight against the steel and fused to blow inward. Kelly took his time, checking each one, starting with the first rank 10 feet above the bottom. He did it quickly because he didn't want to be down here that long, and neither did the others. The men behind him ran the primacord, wrapping it tight around the blocks. Both were local, experienced UDT men, trained almost as well as Kelly. He checked their work, and they checked his, for caution and thoroughness was the mark of such men. They finished the lower level in 20 minutes, and came up slowly to the upper rank, just 10 feet below the surface, where the process was repeated, slowly and carefully. When you dealt with explosives, you didn't rush and you didn't take chances. Colonel Robin Zacharias concentrated on the task at hand. There was an SA-2 site just over the next ridge. Already it had volleyed off 3 missiles, searching for the fighter bombers he was here to protect. In the back seat of his F-105G Thunder Chief was Jack Tate, his bear, a lieutenant colonel and an expert in the field of defense suppression. The two men had helped invent the doctrine which they were now implementing. He drove the Wild Weasel fighter, showing himself, trying to draw a shot, then ducking under it, closing in on the rocket site. It was a deadly, vicious game, not of hunter and prey, but of hunter and hunter, one small, swift, and delicate, and the other massive, fixed, and fortified. This site had given fits to the men of his wing. The commander was just too good with his radar, knowing when to switch it on and when to switch it off. Whoever the little bastard was, he'd killed 2 weasels under Robin's command in the previous week. And so the colonel had drawn the mission for himself as soon as the frag order had gone up to hit this area again. It was his specialty, diagnosing, penetrating, and destroying air defenses. A vast, rapid, 3-dimensional game in which the prize of winning was survival. He was roaring low, never higher than 500 feet, his fingers controlling the stick semi-automatically, while Zacharias's eyes watched the karst hilltops, and his ears listened to the talk from the back seat. "He's at our 9, Robin," Jack told him. "Still sweeping, but he doesn't have us. Spiraling in nicely." "We're not going to give him a shrike," Zacharias thought. "They tried that the last time, and he spoofed it somehow. That error had cost him a major, a captain, and an aircraft. A fellow native of Salt Lake City, Al Wallace. Friends for years. Damn it, he shook the thought off, not even reproving himself for the lowercase profanity. Giving him another taste, Zacharias said, pulling back on the stick. The thud leapt upwards into the radar coverage of the site, hovering there, waiting. This site commander was probably Russian-trained. They weren't sure how many aircraft the man had killed, only that it had been more than enough. But he had to be a proud one because of it, and pride was deadly in this business. Launch, two. Two valid launches, Robin, Tate warned from the back. Only two, the pilot asked. Maybe he has to pay for them, Tate suggested coolly. I have them at 9. Time to do some pilot magic, Rob. Like this? Zacharias rolled left to keep them in view, pulling into them, and split-essing back down. He'd planned it well, ducking behind a ridge. He pulled out at a dangerous low altitude, but the SA-2 guideline missiles went wild and dumb 4,000 feet over his head. I think it's time, Tate said. I think you're right. Zacharias turned hard left, arming his cluster munitions. The F-105 skimmed over the ridge, dropping back down again while his eyes checked the next ridge, 6 miles and 50 seconds away. His radar is still up, Tate reported. He knows we're coming. But he's only got one left. Unless his reload crews are really hot today. Well, you can't allow for everything. Some light flak at 10 o'clock. It was too far to be a matter of concern, though it did tell him which way out not to take. There's the plateau. Maybe they could see him, maybe not. Possibly he was just one moving blip amid a screen full of clutter that some radar operator was striving to understand. The thud moved faster at low level than anything ever made, and the camouflage motif on the upper surfaces was effective. They were probably looking up. There was a wall of jamming there now, part of the plan he'd laid out for the other weasel bird, and normal American tactics were for a medium-altitude approach and steep dive. But they'd done that twice and failed, and so Zacharias decided to change the technique. Low level, he'd rock-eye the place, then the other weasel would finish things off. His job was killing the command van and the commander within. He jinked the thud left and right, up and down, to deny a good shooting track to anybody on the ground. You still had to worry about guns, too. Got the star, Robin said. The SA-6 manual, written in Russian, called for 6 launchers around a central control point. With all the connective paths, the typical guideline site looked just like a Star of David, which seemed rather blasphemous to the colonel, but the thought only hovered at the edge of his mind as he centered the command van on his bombsight pipper. Selecting Rockeye, he said aloud, confirming the action to himself. For the last 10 seconds he held the aircraft rock steady. Looking good. Release. Now. 4 of the decidedly un-aerodynamic canisters fell free of the fighter's ejector racks, splitting open in midair, scattering thousands of submunitions over the area. He was well beyond the site before the bomblets landed. He didn't see people running for slit trenches, but he stayed low, reefing the thud into a tight left turn, looking up to make sure he'd gotten the place once and for all. From 3 miles out, his eyes caught an immense cloud of smoke in the center of the star. That's for Al, he allowed himself to think. No victory roll, just a thought, as he leveled out and picked a likely spot to egress the area. The strike force could come in now, and that SAM battery was out of business. Okay. He selected a notch in the ridge, racing for it just under Mach 1, straight and level now that the threat was behind him. Home for Christmas. The red tracers that erupted from the small pass startled him. That wasn't supposed to be there. No deflection on them, just coming right in. He jinked up, as the gunner had thought he would, and the body of the aircraft passed right through the stream of fire. It shook violently, and in the passage of a second, good changed to evil. Robin, a voice gasped over the intercom. But the main noise was from wailing alarms. And Zacharias knew...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.